Welcome to Pocket Fiction by Steve Cook. Poisonroot, Chapter 13. Downriver by Steamer.
Get this crate loaded on, lad. Chop chop.
Trip shook his head, levering himself up from the crate he was sat on. The sun was high in the air, and they had been moving heavy boxes for hours. Wearily, he turned and picked up the unwieldy wooden box. It had fragile arborometers stenciled onto the top. His aching feet carried him onto the brass-bottomed bell and into the small covered shed that served as a temporary cargo hold and wheelhouse. He put the crate in an empty space and looked around. The wheelhouse was crammed full of brass tubes and dials. Glass glinted in the sunlight, covering gauges for steam pressure and thrust and torque. It was quite nothing he had ever seen before.
"She's a beauty, isn't she?" came Lauren's voice from outside.
She struggled into the wheelhouse and put down her own crate. She stood up straight and stretched. "She's beautiful. Thank you for what you're doing for us."
"No problem. So, Trip, right?"
he nodded.
"Is that short for anything, or—"
"No. It's just my name," he replied. "I've never really known why. I guess it sounded nice." He nudged the crate she'd just brought in with one sandaled foot.
"Are there any more?"
"Nope. Last one. We're pretty much good to go."
Lauren untied the apron she'd been wearing for the loading.
"This is all the important stuff."
"What is all this, anyway?" In answer, she bent and opened one of the crates. It was filled with straw padding, which was protecting a dozen small globes of glass, each containing a small coil of metal encased in amber.
"It's Dad's legacy to me. Did you see the lights in the workshop? And the town? They're amberostatic."
"I know what amber is. They've been working with it for years."
"Who's they?"
she said with a mischievous smile playing round her lips.
"Just people," Trip blushed. "You know, researchers. I read it in a report."
Lauren put the lid back on the crate.
"You're very lucky then. It's almost unknown to most here in Lyria. One of those researchers was my father. The amber lights most places have now are little better than candles. They're incredibly expensive to run, delicate, impossible to maintain without a qualified SIC Epsilon-level engineer, and frankly, horribly ugly."
Tapping the top of the resealed crate, she smiled.
"These are the answer. Cheaper, almost disposable. These will revolutionise amber lighting. Didn't you see how bright it was in the workshop? That's at least 100 candle power light in there from any one bulb."
She rocked back on her heels and smiled.
"PID is wired up. A little thank you from Father for letting him work here. But it's almost the only place in Lyria that is. They're more common in Koru and Zar, though."
"And you're taking them to Fenica," Trip said, sorting through his memory. "But not to the SIC. You must be taking them to someone with money. Someone who could help you get the edge over the SIC. The Duke of Fenica?"
"Exactly," she said, and patted him on the head, laughing as he scowled. "You're pretty smart. The Duke himself has expressed an interest in having sole distribution rights over these. I hear that the SIC insulted him in some way and, well, he's perfect."
"Who's perfect?" Victor said, stepping on board.
He was carrying the two travelling packs, which he threw on top of the crates.
"You are, of course," Lauren said, winking at Trip.
He smothered a grin as Victor looked from one to the other.
Reckon we can leave now."
"Pull in the gangplanks. I locked up the workshop, so I'm all set if you are."
Lauren's infectious happiness caught Trip up in its wake. He found himself grinning as she pulled levers and the rumbling under his feet increased in intensity. With a lurch, they set off. Victor lost no time in sitting at the back of the ship in the shade, sword out and whetstone in hand. Swaying slightly as the boat moved out into the middle of the wide river, Trip wandered up to watch.
"Nothing," Trip said.
He sat and listened to the rhythmic metal scraping sound mixing with the various rattles and throbbing of the bell. Then it stopped mid-stroke.
"What, boy?"
Trip bit his lip and frowned.
"I just wanted to say thanks."
"What for?"
"Being here, I guess. Teaching me to fight. Saving me in that cave under Deep Round."
The sound of the whetstone started again, slower this time.
"You paid me, boy. Remember? Hired me."
"You didn't have to say yes, though," Trip replied.
There was a silence between them that stretched on for minutes. After a while, the boy got up and left the man to his tools. There was nothing more he could bring himself to say at that moment, and the day was too fresh for bad feelings. The bell made amazing time.
Trip could feel the wind in his face as he stood at what he now knew was the prow of the ship, not the front. Victor was taking a turn at the wheel and the river was clear as glass all around them. Lauren placed a slender hand on his shoulder. Victor told me about the monastery and everything. It's okay.
No, it's not. She turned him round. You went through something terrible. I know I don't know you, hardly met you. But if you want to talk, I'm here.
Trip looked up into her eyes as if properly seeing her for the first time. He shrugged her hand off, then turned back to face the front.
Thanks, but I'm fine. What about you? Why did you agree to come all this way with us?
She sighed heavily.
Back at the workshop, remember I told you about the SIC? The Science and Industry College. They've been sending men out every month trying to force me to hand over Dad's blueprints. Let's just say that I was never on the best of terms with them. It always seemed like they stole Dad's best stuff from him.
So aren't you worried they'll just come in and take it while you're gone?
I suppose they could. They're not criminals, though, just bad news. At least, I hope.
She pulled the gold locket out of her shirt again and started absentmindedly twirling it through her fingers. Sunlight winked off the tiny inscribed design.
Dad always used to say he'd keep on their good side just enough to get the resources he needed. Now he's gone, his reputation's gone with him.
Lauren gripped the railing and scowled.
They don't believe women can be good engineers, you see.
But that's ridiculous, Trip protested. You got the bell running, and I saw Pam back at the workshop. All those things you've done. It doesn't matter if you're a woman, as long as you have hands and a brain, right? Impulsively, Lauren turned and hugged him tightly.
Would that all the world thought like you do, Trip, she said,
and he revelled in the feel of a comforting arm around him.
Ship ahead!
Trip felt Lauren's arm tense around him. He looked up to see some sort of wooden raft making its way along the wide river towards them. It had no sail, no oars, no apparent means of going at all. Then a figure jumped up onto its bow, arms spread, far too wide for a human. It opened its bark-covered mouth impossibly wide and screeched, sharp foot-long wooden talons snicking out. Its muscles were corded like bunched-up vines. They bulged and throbbed as it crouched down, still hissing. As the other vessel came alongside, the tree demon howled into the air towards them.